Harper Perennial and Harper Audio present Witness to Hope, the biography of Pope John Paul II by George Weigel. Read by Sam Tsoutsouvas. Preface. Shortly after the death of Pope John Paul II, on April 2, 2005, Henry Kissinger told NBC News that it would be difficult to imagine anyone having a greater impact on the 20th century than the Polish priest and bishop who, on the night of his election in 1978, had described himself as a man called to Rome from a far country. Kissinger's assessment was all the more striking in that the former U.S. Secretary of State, himself a consequential figure in modern history, had no religious or philosophical stake in the life, thoughts, and actions of Karl Josef Wojtyła. A decade and a half later, it is still worth pondering just what Kissinger's extraordinary tribute might mean. If John Paul II was indeed the emblematic human personality of the 20th century, why was that the case? And what was the relationship between the achievement of the Polish Pope, for both the Church and the world, and the heroic virtue the Catholic Church formally recognized in him when he was canonized as Saint John Paul II on April 27, 2014? In a conversation in the papal apartment in March 1996, John Paul II said of previous biographers' efforts to tell his life story, "They try to understand me from outside, but I can only be understood from inside." He knew by then that he was a figure of historic consequence. Yet his story, he insisted, was one that could only be read from the inside out, through the prism of his soul, if those who sought to understand him and his accomplishments were to truly grasp what made him tick. So, on this 20th anniversary of the publication of Witness to Hope, revisiting the soul of St. John Paul II will set the story of his life through the year 2000 in its appropriate frame. Karl Wojtyła, the man who became John Paul II, had an intensely Polish soul, not only in the sense of a personality formed by a particular ethnic experience, but in the larger sense of a soul formed by a distinctive history and culture. Born in 1920, he was a member of the first generation of Poles born in an independent Polish state since the late 18th century. But it was the Polish national experience between the elimination of Poland from the map of Europe in 1795 and the restoration of its national independence in 1918 that was decisive for forming the soul of John Paul II. During those 123 years in the wilderness, years when Poland did not appear on any map of Europe, Poland the nation survived the vivisection of Poland the state through its culture, its language, its literature, and its Catholic faith. That century and a quarter of culturally based national resistance to political subjugation, during which the Catholic Church was the safe deposit box of Polish identity, left a profound impression on Wojtyła's soul, and was decisive in shaping the thoughts and actions of John Paul II. From that experience, he discerned that the real driver of history over time is neither politics nor economics, but rather culture. At the heart of any culture, as at the beginning of the word culture, is cult. What do people cherish and worship? Thus, far from being a non-factor in modernity, religious conviction and the truths Christianity teaches about the inalienable dignity of every human life can be a dynamic, creative force, bending history in a more human direction. When Wojtyla was elected pope on October 16, 1978, much of the Catholic Church in the West found itself in a defensive crouch. The man who became John Paul II could summon the church to a new evangelical and public dynamism because his soul had been formed by a different experience, an experience of the church as the bearer of the most potent vision of human possibility on offer. Karol Wojtyła also had a Carmelite soul. His youthful attempts to enter monastic life as a Carmelite had been rebuffed. But his spiritual life, and indeed his entire view of the human condition, was profoundly shaped by his encounter as a young man with the spiritual writings of the classic Carmelite reformers of the 16th century, St. John of the Cross and St. Teresa of Avila. From those Carmelite mystics, he learned that the central truth of human history is found at the cross of Christ. Human beings come to fulfillment, or, if you will, beatitude, not through the assertion of self, but through the gift of self in obedience to God's will. In his mature philosophical work at the Catholic University of Lublin, Wojtyła would refine this conviction intellectually and would put the law of the gift, or the law of self-giving, at the very foundation of his ethics. As each of our lives is a gift to us, so must we make our lives into gifts for others. That refinement was only possible, however, because of the original perception. Rather than being a hideous cruelty or an absurdity, the self-sacrificing death of Jesus Christ, which was then vindicated by his resurrection into a new and superabundant form of life, is the axial point of human history. Here, in the death and resurrection of Christ, the deepest truths about human destiny were and are revealed. Here, in the embrace of obedience to God's will, human beings are truly liberated. Here, in the demonstration that death does not have the final word in either our individual stories or in the story of humanity, is the source of a courage that can overcome fear and match, even conquer, worldly power. The Carmelite dimension of John Paul's richly textured soul was amplified by what might be called the Marian dimension of his interior life. That deep part of his personality formed by his self-understanding as a spiritual son of the Virgin Mary, under whose protection he placed his life and his pontificate. Polish devotion to the Virgin Mary, embodied in the Black Madonna of Częstochowa, is well known. This Marian dimension of Wojtyła's soul was not, however, simply the absorption of a traditional, emotionally vibrant form of Polish piety. For during the Second World War, under the influence of the lay mystic Jan Tiranowski and the theological writings of Saint-Louis Guignon de Montfort, young Karol Wojtyła began to understand that all true Christian devotion to Mary is Christocentric and Trinitarian. Mary's role in the history of salvation is not as some sort of independent feminine principle, but as the first witness to Christ, her son. "Do whatever he tells you," as she instructs the waiters at the wedding feast in Cana in the second chapter of John's Gospel. Mary always points to her son. And because Jesus is both Son of Mary and Son of God, by pointing us to her Son, Mary points us into the great mystery of the Trinity, the God who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. During his pontificate, John Paul II would draw on this Marian dimension of his soul to deepen Catholicism's traditional Marian piety, constantly pointing to Mary as the paradigm of all Christian discipleship. Mary's articulated yes to the angelic invitation to be the God-bearer, Luke chapter 1, verse 38, sets the pattern. Mary's silent yes at the foot of the cross, memorably captured in Michelangelo's Pietà, confirms that obedience to God's will, even in the most profound suffering, is ultimately liberating. And here, as in his cruciform or Carmelite soul, John Paul II lived a profound challenge to the late modern and postmodern insistence that radical personal autonomy is the royal road to happiness and human flourishing. Then there was the dramatic dimension of Karol Wojtyła's soul. As a young man obsessed, as he once put it, with the theater, Wojtyła acquired skills that would serve him well as a public personality, both as Archbishop of Krakow and as Pope. More important, however, his theatrical experience as both actor and playwright formed a soul with a distinctive view of the human condition. Each of us, he came to understand, lives in a dramatic situation, for we live each day in the gap between the person I am and the person I ought to be. Understanding that, we come to grasp that life is never dull or repetitive. Living in such a way as to close the gap between who I am now and what I aspire to be is inherently dramatic, adventurous, and dynamic. What we sometimes call the human drama is not just the story of those large-scale figures who dominate the history books. The human drama is, in fact, the spiritual and moral life of every human person. And the task of the Church and its ministers, Pope John Paul II would insist, is to accompany men and women in the drama of their lives, exploring each life's uniquely dramatic circumstances, while offering the mercy and forgiveness of Christ when the drama takes a bad turn. This conviction that all of life is dramatically structured, and that the ultimate playwright of the human drama is none other than God, helps explain the otherwise inexplicable magnetism that John Paul II had for young people all over the world. At a cultural moment when pandering to the young was the order of the day, John Paul II did not pander. He challenged. But because he also made it clear that he, too, lived in that dramatic gap that is everyone's human circumstance, his challenge had the ring of authenticity. He was not asking young people to accept any challenge he had not accepted, take any risk he had not taken, or bear any burden he had not borne. He was, instead, asking them to pursue, with courage, the instinct for the heroic and the noble that was their human birthright, even in a world of sin and evil. Never, ever settle, he would say in many variations on a common theme, for anything less than the spiritual and moral greatness that the grace of God makes possible in your life. And when you fail, as we all do, don't lower the bar of expectation. Get up, seek forgiveness, be reconciled to God and others, and then continue the great dramatic adventure of life in the gap. Live in those terms, he suggested, and you will never, ever find life anything other than exhilarating, no matter how hard it becomes. The priestly soul of John Paul II and his understanding of priestly ministry as the clarifying, challenging, and grace-bestowing accompaniment of others through the drama of life has been noted. Karol Wojtyła also had what can be accurately described as a lay soul. He was the first pope in centuries who, until he was a young adult, had intended to live out his Catholic life as a layman. 2 decades before the Second Vatican Council defined the universal call to holiness in the Church, Wojtyła already knew, not least from his father, the dominant influence on his young life, that sanctity was not a matter for the church sanctuary only. Sanctity was every Christian's baptismal vocation, and sanctity was to be sought and lived in the world, not in an ecclesiastical bunker. Thus, for John Paul II, Catholicism could not be understood as a lifestyle or recreational choice to be indulged for an hour or so on Sunday and then put aside in order to return to the real world. Rather, Catholic faith embraces and illuminates all of life, and everything the believer does, be it in the family or the workplace, as a consumer or as a citizen, is to be sanctified by Catholic lives and by God's grace working through those lives. Thus, John Paul II, who loved the gift of his priesthood and inspired priestly vocations in tens of thousands of young men, was concurrently the least clerical of high ecclesiastics, for he knew and lived his priestly vocation as a servant of the sanctity, happiness, and ultimately beatitude of others. Finally, there was what might be called the humanistic layer of Karol Wojtyła's soul, that deep part inside him that was formed by his experience with what he believed to be the great crisis of his time, the crisis in the very idea of the human person. That ideas have consequences was more than a philosopher's slogan for Wojtyła. He knew the truth of that maxim in his bones, as he had experienced it both in the Second World War and in the communist usurpation of Poland's post-war liberties. But if wicked ideas could be death-dealing in their consequences, a proper idea of the dignity and value of every human life, the idea that anti-communist dissidents in the 1980s would call living in the truth, could be liberating. First, in individual lives shaped by aroused consciences, later, in great public movements of cultural, social, and political renewal. And the great role of the church in the late modern and postmodern worlds, he believed, was to rescue the idea of the human person from the doldrums, and worse, into which it had fallen. The 20th century, as a historical epoch rather than a calendrical calculation, the years between the onset of World War I in 1914 and the collapse of...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.